Hello, my name is Gary Bledsoe. Today we're going to talk about dynamic functional knee bracing. This can be divided into three categories: the background, the problem itself, and the dynamic bracing solution. I'd like to start by going through some background information on ACL injuries. In young athletes, the force required to fail an anterior cruciate ligament is quite high, about 33 newtons per kilogram of body mass. This is a force capable of lifting 3.3 times the body's weight. About 80% of ACL failures occur without any external contact. Simply put, the ACL fails because internally generated physiological forces rise too high, too fast for the muscles to react and recruit. In reconstructed ACL knees, literature shows a failure rate of 27% in autografts and 38% in allografts 2 to 5 years post-reconstruction. Elite athletes usually have the highest failure rates. These grafts are subjected to stretching forces without the protection of the hamstrings muscle. Now let's look at an ACL deficient knee. Did you see it? What do we do for this problem? Reconstruct the knee? That was done, an autograft, and it failed in 3 years. What's next? Another reconstruction? That was also done. That was an allograft, and it failed in 2 years. Try physical therapy? Hamstrings training alone cannot prevent tibial subluxation in the last 15 degrees of extension. What we have is a timing problem, and the only conservative solution may be dynamic bracing. Now let's look at the problem in greater detail. In an anterior cruciate ligament deficient knee, the quadriceps muscle causes the tibia to translate anteriorly in the last 30 degrees of extension. This was cited by Renstrom in 1986. One of the major issues is the time that it takes for the hamstrings to react to the subluxation. In a normal knee, from the time the tibia begins to move until the hamstrings respond is about 40 to 50 milliseconds. In an ACL deficient knee, it is much slower, 100 to 150 milliseconds. In reconstructed knees, that time does not change. It is still about 2 to 3 times slower than in a healthy knee. Even up to 8 years postoperatively, no one has documented that nerves grow back in an ACL ligament graft. There are basically four things that anterior cruciate ligament deficient patients have difficulty doing: stopping quickly, running downhill, landing after jumping, and moving laterally. These four maneuvers share some common elements. First, the muscle must contract early. It takes time for muscle recruitment. The quadriceps muscle must extend the tibia. It does not extend out by itself. The hamstrings muscles do not react in time, so the tibia subluxes. There isn't a lot of rotation or joint compression because there's no co-contraction. The tibia is subluxed prior to foot strike. This is the primary difficulty. This was demonstrated by Dr. Bob Jackson using an instrumented spatial linkage device. This particular graph shows one patient walking through one complete gait cycle. The red line shows the gait cycle of the patient's ACL deficient leg. The green shows the gait cycle of the same patient's healthy leg. On the left, the vertical line represents one foot strike. On the right, the second vertical line shows the next foot strike after one complete gait cycle. The horizontal line in the middle is the neutral tibial position. Note at foot strike, the red line shows the tibia is anterior. It is subluxed at foot strike. As we go through mid stance, rock through, toe off, and swing phase, we note that as we swing and extend toward the next foot strike, the tibia subluxes. Tom Andriaki, a well-known motion analysis expert, also demonstrated that the tibia was subluxed prior to foot strike in ACL-deficient knees. He did this using a multi-camera motion analysis system and published his results in the Journal of Biomechanics in 2005. Hirakawa demonstrated that the hamstrings cannot control tibial subluxation in the last 15 degrees of extension. Once the tibia is subluxed, compression of the condyles at foot strike now prevents joint reduction. So let's look at the dynamic bracing solution. What is dynamic bracing? Dynamic bracing is the use of movement or muscle power to apply a corrective force at the moment of medical need, then remove that force when no need exists. Dynamic bracing works with the body against pathological movements. In the case of ACL bracing, dynamic braces use quadriceps power to place an increasingly higher force against the tibia as the knee moves into the final 30 degrees of extension. This dynamic force stops the tibia from subluxing in the moment of need prior to foot strike. Let's look at a quick video animation of a brace in motion. Notice the front tibial strap. In flexion, there is no force applied. As the knee moves into extension, a counterforce is applied. The counterforce pushes against the tibia, causing the upper thigh shell to tilt slightly, increasing the force against the posterior distal hamstrings. This increasing shear force is what keeps the tibia in proper alignment prior to foot strike. Acierno in 1995 demonstrated that symptomatic ACL-deficient patients who wore dynamic braces were able to do maximal effort isokinetic extension with no quadriceps inhibition or anterior translation. The symptoms were therefore reduced or completely eliminated. Those same subluxing forces that we see in ACL-deficient knees place a high force on reconstructed ligament grafts that have no nerves to protect themselves. This eventually results in a high percentage of stretched grafts that could have otherwise been protected by dynamic braces. So why is dynamic bracing required? The strap tension necessary to control tibial subluxation or to reduce the stress on an ACL ligament graft is about 3 times the level that would block circulation. In most cases, static or passive braces cannot be tensioned enough without restricting circulation or causing severe discomfort. Let's look at the benefits of dynamic bracing. Controlling tibial subluxation before foot strike is the key to protecting ACL-deficient knees that cannot or will not be reconstructed. Dynamic bracing can also reduce the cyclic loading strain on reconstructed ligaments that could otherwise cause ligament creep and subsequent stretch failures in ACL-reconstructed athletes. Another interesting benefit of dynamic bracing is the auto-training effect of the hamstrings. The rapid change in strap force from a dynamic brace can cause a hamstring's tonic reflex contraction in terminal extension. This becomes a learned response, like Pavlov's dog, and the effect can remain from days to weeks after brace removal, according to Solomonow. This is extremely important for sports where braces cannot be worn during play, but the athletes must practice both with and without the brace to develop proprioception and muscle patterning so that this hamstring's effect is present when the brace is removed for sports play. Let's provide a recap of dynamic functional knee bracing. First, ACL-deficient knees sublux prior to foot strike. Dynamic braces apply a counterforce in the moment of need to prevent subluxation before foot strike and prevent the chain of events from occurring. The symptoms are therefore significantly reduced or eliminated. By using a variation of dynamic bracing in the opposite direction, posterior cruciate ligament deficient knees can also be treated. Finally, dynamic braces can be used to help prevent reconstructed grafts from stretching or undergoing ligament creep. Thank you for taking the time to learn about dynamic functional knee bracing. For additional information, visit www.breg.com/dynamic.